So today I'm going to talk to you about some of the work we've been doing on predators for Lebbeck mealybug. Since we are learning very quickly that this is a pest that's really hard to get under control with insecticides alone, we kind of knew this was going to happen. This is what we saw in other countries, but we had some other chemistries to try, so we've tested a bunch of stuff. This is ongoing work, and we're still growing from what we're learning. So the first question is, are there predators for Lebbeck mealybug in Florida? So we wanted to figure this out. And we do know that predators can be a more effective control measure for this particular species of mealybug just based on how it does its life cycle, which I showed you this morning. And you saw more of it during the first hands-on session. And as a newer pest, sometimes it takes a while before the predators actually show up and establish and are here at sufficient levels to really help us out. So we wanted to see if we had anybody out there right now who could eat this and could possibly have an impact on the population. And we did this through a combination of molecular tests for gut content to see what out there in the trees could we sample that might be eating these, just to get an idea of who's out there. Really, you know, rough data sets, large taxonomic groupings. And then based on that, we've refined that into looking at some predation assays. And then we've also reared stuff out from field collected colonies to see if there's anybody in there. Sorry, there's the field collection I mentioned. So what we did for this, and you can see Kristen's picture, she's a former master's student between mine and Lucas's labs. And she went out and she DVEC'd, that's a big vacuum basically that she's holding in her hand. And she went out to infested trees and sucked off all the bugs that she could possibly suction off in a set amount of time. And then she killed them on site, because that will help preserve anything that's in their stomachs, brought them back to the laboratory, sorted, identified them by taxonomic grouping, refined that as much as we could. And then the hardest part of it actually is that she started having to, she had to make a primer, so it's a molecular marker for us to figure out exactly what they're eating. And this mealybug had some weird chemistry in its inside, so it took her some time to figure that part out. But now we have a molecular primer, and she was able to figure out who's actually interacting with this mealybug, if they're either eating the mealybug itself, or we also have found out that the mealybug excretes some of its genetic material in its honeydew, which is very abnormal. Most hemipteran insects don't do that, so you don't normally find their DNA in their honeydew, which made that a little more complicated data set than we expected. So from the gut content, we had those DNA primers specific to Lebbeck mealybug. We tested them across a bunch of mealybugs, different species that we could find that were abundant in citrus and in nurseries, asked people to go in their backyard. This is when everything was kind of closed down, but we could still do a little bit of research. And then once we started, we realized it was very specific to them. We purchased a bunch of Cryptolamus montrosuri, which is the mealybug destroyer, one of the best predators for almost every mealybug species. And we fed the mealybugs to the mealybug destroyers to get an idea of how long after they ate we could actually detect the DNA. We want to see if this is a viable thing to take to the field and see if we could actually figure out who's eating it. In doing that, we figured out there's a pretty decent retention time, a couple days. We could still collect DNA from their guts. We'd had to amplify it a lot. So we figured we can do this. So we went out and we took her samples that she had already collected that were sitting in the freezer, and we started looking at who tested positive for having that DNA associated with them. And we found spiders, beetles, which is not surprising. That's where the cryptolamus is going to be. Neuropterans, these are going to be your lacewings, amongst a couple other things. Hemiptera, this is a huge group of predatory insects. Piercing, sucking bugs. There are a lot of predatory ones that are out there. And Orthoptera, they probably ate the mealybugs with bycatch. It was on the leaves that they were consuming. I don't think they're an intentional predator. So from Kristen's work, we moved into actually doing some assays with things that looked promising. And this was work done by Eric Middleton, a former postdoc in my group. And we wanted to actually look at these predation assays and say, okay, they can eat them, but are they actually worth investing in? And is it a good option? So these are laboratory assays. And we tested a range of wild collected and lab acclimated. So that means we went out to the field, we collected what was out there and active in the field, and then we fed them on a control diet in the lab, just some brine shrimp eggs, they love them. And then we fed them mealybugs to see how much they would consume of those mealybugs and if they would even eat them. Some of them won't. And then we tried to figure out what life stages they could consume and how much they would eat. So for the next couple of slides, you're gonna see this graph or this chart here. And we'll have a series of commercial predators, so this is stuff you can buy. Wild predators, this is who we collected from the field. Not exhausted, it depends on what we were able to find out there. Larvae consume, so this is good, this is the best, more than 10 a day, more than 5 a day, and then less than 5 a day, probably not going to be great. And then this other column will populate with ovisacs, which is a tricky one for a lot of predators. So the predators that consume 10 or more larvae per day, the ones that you can buy, it's going to be your Cryptolamus montrosuri. This is the juvenile. It looks like a gigantic mealybug, but it walks differently. And then that's the adult of it. Lacewings, certain species of lacewings can eat it quite efficiently. And then for the wild ones, we have earwigs, which can also be a pest. So it's kind of a delicate balance on these. The Curinus, which if you didn't get a chance to see them, Javad brought a nice little colony of them up here, so it's kind of fun to see. And our trash bugs, which is the native lacewings that we're going to find in the field. I can never say the genus name right, so he said it earlier. We're just going to go with that. They are fantastic predators. And then the other ones are probably going to be contributing to some level consuming them, aside from maybe these guys. I wouldn't invest in diomas or pirate bugs or hippodamia, these ones you can buy down here. These really didn't do a whole heck of a lot. They'd come up and interact with them, but they didn't really, they'd bite it and walk away. They weren't interested. The hemolymph, which is the gut of the bug, has some really toxic chemistry in it, so it's really hard for a lot of insects to ingest this particular species. So that is a kink in the system of predators. So okay, ovisacs. We know this one's hard. The wax is really thick. If you saw that earlier today, it's thick, sticky wax. It's hard to get through. We struggle with it just to even get at it with chemistries. So the lacewings that are available for purchase did not do good on the ovisacs. They would actually, they're down here now. They would come up to it, they would snap at it trying to eat it, and then they would come away with wax all over their mandibles, and then they would die after a few days. So that is not a great option as far as if you're going to buy something. And then the best options we found overall, and this is going to be across the commercial and the wild collected, your Cryptolamus montrosuri, your earwigs, and trash bugs. So a lot of these we have in our system already. It's not enough yet, so we need some other predators. So we were actually really excited that when we did some laboratory rearing assays, we found some other stuff out there. So these are other things that you're going to find in your field. We didn't get enough to fully test them. But if you see these, this larva right here is kind of a gigantic wiggling booger shape. It becomes this fly. It is a really fantastic predator of all things soft and squishy. And it's Fregosa species. We're actually waiting on the species designation for it. It's a new species for us in Florida. Anatrachus batia, which is the pink scavenger moth. They used to think it was just eating the debris, but we actually documented it feeding on the mealybug. So this one's super common. I've seen a bunch of these. I've even seen them established in some cups houses, so that's really promising. If you see this, please leave it. We want it. It's good. And then we have some parasites. So we have Anagyrus dactylopi and a prostatitis species, another one that we're waiting on the actual species name. We sent it off, but sometimes the specimens things are identified with, which is this guy right here, are damaged, and so we have to wait for further taxonomic refinement. But we have some stuff that's establishing, and we're working with a biocontrol specialist to actually evaluate these more thoroughly to see if they're things that we can possibly try to support in our systems, because they really do a great job. We had the Anagyrus get into our colony and tear up quite a bit of our mealybug colony, which was cool, but not cool at the same time. It was pretty bad for us. So the predators are important. The more we can support them being there, the better. And so one of the other things you can do to support your predators is to think about ants. I mentioned that this morning. We know that ants are a challenge. If you go out and you have these mealybugs, you look at them, they're probably going to be tended by ants. And there's lots of different species that will tend them. And we talk about tending. They're basically going up to the mealybugs, getting, you can see it right here, this honeydew from them. It's a nice sugary solution. It's food. And then they protect them from predators. They also groom them. So sometimes if you're spraying EPS, the fungal spores don't always have a chance because the ants will take them right off. And of everybody that's out in the field, the fire ants are the most aggressive. All the other ones that are out there, you can tap the branch and they're going to run away. But the fire ants will stay and fight, and they're going to fight for their food resource. So we know that we really do need to incorporate management for the fire ants if Lebbeck's a problem in our field, if you want predators there. So this was a study we did, and Eric led it also. We did it with a colleague at University of Central Florida who is a fire ant specialist. And one of the things he works on is in conservation areas, this boiling water application. I didn't get the video to work, so I'm sorry. I can't show you that, guys, but it's pretty cool. We essentially have boiling hot water. We put it down with a pipe into the ant nest, and we boil them. It's extremely satisfying, but it didn't work as well as we wanted it to. And then we also looked at some ground applications. We were using chlorpyrifos until the label changed, so then we switched over to bifenthrin. And then we had two baits in this trial, clinch and extinguish. And then we had a control where we didn't treat. And so I'm going to show you the crazy looking data here, but pay attention to right here. The baits work really well. They work better than any of the other tools that we tested. So if you need to manage for fire ants, consider using a bait. You're going to get more bang for your buck, longer term management, and it does knock down the whole colony, because when the foragers take them back to their colony, they feed up to the larvae consume them, the excretions from the larvae get fed to the rest of the colony, so that chemistry goes through the whole colony, it will actually knock out your colonies. And these are mound counts. You can actually see a reduction in fire ant colonies over time, more significantly in the baits than any other treatment. So it's really worth taking the time to put those out. We hand applied those, by the way, and I don't recommend that. So if you have a better way to apply it, do that. So, of course, the question is, will it actually support the predators? And the answer, yeah, it does. You knock them out, and you see where the fire ants were reduced or removed, we see a lot more predators in general establishing versus where the ants were left to do their thing and to be there and to protect them. So, again, if you have Lebbeck mealybug and you want your predators to have a chance at them, you really need to take care of those fire ants. And that's actually all I'm going to show you for today. We have more work to do on this section, but it's promising. We're excited about it. I have a lot of people, again, to thank. We've got a lot of hands that helped with this, a lot of funding that helped with this.